Hey, everybody, welcome to the Jeff Rubin, Jeff Rubin Show. I'm Jeff Rubin, and I call this the Jeff Rubin, Jeff Rubin Show because I wanted the subject matter to be limited only by saying it's things that I, Jeff Rubin, am interested in. And one of my favorite things in the world is Settlers of Catan. It's an incredible board game. And real quick, before we get into talking about Game of Thrones with John Gabris, I wanted to tell you guys about a rule variant for Settlers of Catan that I've been using to speed up the game. So, obviously we all know that when Settlers of Catan starts, the players set up the game by taking turns placing two initial settlements. However, under tournament rules, players each take turns placing a settlement, and then the players take turns placing a city, and players still take only one resource card for that second placement. I mean, don't get greedy here, you're already getting double production on your second placement. But what's great about this is it kind of just lops off the first 10-15% of the game. And satisfying Catan experience. And Catan is not a long game. It's not like Monopoly. If you sit down to play it, you are going to finish. But they do this in tournaments because they need to get so many games in every day so you can really get to the bottom of who's the best. And I've been doing it because there are situations where I want to play Settlers of Catan, even though there is clearly not enough time to do it, and I just gotta get my fix in anyway. Settlers of Catan has been a passion of mine for a long time, but a new love that has recently entered my life is Game of Thrones, and that is the subject of today's episode. I'm going to be talking to John Gabris, who is one of the funniest people I know. He's been on my other shows, Bleep Bloop and Nerd Alert, probably twice as much as whoever has been on the second most. I knew I had to have him on this show immediately, and thankfully, he is a huge Game of Thrones fan. He is one of those people that read the books before the show started, and those people, way to get in on the ground floor. When you were, before the show started, when you were waving those 1,000-page fantasy tomes in front of me, I was extremely skeptical. But since watching the show, I have actually started to read the books, and that's something John and I will talk about. The first half of this conversation has no Game of Thrones spoilers. You can listen to it, even if you haven't watched the show yet and you're planning on watching it. We will clearly warn you before we start to get into the specifics of the show. So if you guys are ready, let's talk about Game of Thrones. The reason I don't feel bad doing this, even though we already kind of had a conversation on camera about Game of Thrones, is because when we first spoke about it, I think it was after one, maybe two episodes, and the tone was like, what do you think? Like, tell me about Game of Thrones. Is this gonna be good? And now I feel like it's the thing. Like, I hear people talking about it all the time, and I loved it. And fantasy has never been my favorite nerd subgenre. Yeah. I'm like more about sci-fi or superheroes, and I fucking love this show. And I feel like in the 2 months or whatever it's been since we last spoke, it's taken on this whole new meaning.
Oh, it's like changed so much. Like, and for me, having read the books, talking to you about the first couple episodes, I was like, just wait, it only gets, like, and I'll say that still now, even after finishing a whole season, just wait, the books keep getting better. Like, this next season is going to be awesome, and hopefully they'll do more than 10 episodes too.
What did you think of the first season of the show?
As a TV show, I thought it was great. It was a great show, and it was a great HBO show. It was like, there was like titties, doggy style, heads being cut off, horses' heads being
cursing,
cut off.
Cursing, a lot of cocks.
Yeah, I love all that shit, you know. So it was a good HBO show, but it was also a good, accurate representation of the books. So there's like no bad news anymore. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, this is a good show, standalone on its own. And it didn't piss off fans, at least not that I've heard of.
Even though it wasn't birthed at HBO, even though it was created somewhere else, it really fit within that HBO model. And I thought maybe this was the best first season of an HBO show.
Yeah. I mean, maybe. The Wire first season was, like, awesome.
I love The Wire.
I hadn't seen a show like that before.
Yeah, I love The Wire. Like, we're at my apartment, and I'm currently pointing at my Wire Complete Series box set,
which is under about 11 boxes of Sellers of Catan. For those of you who don't know what Jeff Rubin... Although, those of you who are listening to this podcast can guess what Jeff Rubin's apartment looks like.
Jeff Rubin studio has a lot of downtime. He needs a lot of video games, and he needs a lot of board games.
When he says, come to the Jeff Rubin studio, he just left off the word apartment. We're in his studio apartment.
But The Wire, I love The Wire.
Yeah, yeah.
But I didn't totally love it. It didn't really click for me until the end of the second season.
To be fair, yeah. And I went, I didn't watch, that wasn't a show I watched week to week either.
I saw the fourth and fifth seasons as they aired, but I caught up with the first three on DVD.
Yeah.
So that, and that's a totally, and that's something new, I think. A TV show like fundamentally changes when you're watching it week to week versus binging on it on DVD?
Wholeheartedly agree. I almost lost it on Lost. Lost is a lot of those that instant grat show when it ends. You're like, you just want to see the next episode. That's like all that matters, right? So when you lose the ability to see, you're like, anytime an episode kind of falls flat, you're like, fuck this show. That's like a 13-day period where you only watch one shitty episode within it. Mm-hmm. Whereas if it's like you're watching it on DVD, you're like, shitty episodes just fucking disappear. You know what I mean? You're like, oh shit, I don't even remember episode 4 because it was so fucking stupid.
It goes the other way too. You can see sometimes you can see flaws that you wouldn't see if you were watching it week to week. Like I was recently watching Friday Night Lights season 2.
Oh, the worst season of that fucking yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm a huge Friday Night Lights fan, but season 2 is absolutely terrible.
There's a lot of things, and I don't know how clear it was if you were watching it on the air, but when you're watching it week to week, there are entire plot lines that are just completely dropped. Major things that happen, like they spend several episodes on Lila meets Santiago in the
jail. Santiago moves in with
Buddy.
And
he moves in, and there's like this, he's learning to be.
Santiago, did you touch my watch? Did you take my watch?
Yeah, I think that's the last Santiago appearance, is he throws a party.
Yeah.
And then like someone steals something, and like he has to like, he wants to prove to his new dad that he's not just a punk. And then you just never see him again.
Yeah, and does he even, he doesn't graduate, or does he quit the team? Because he's not even around in the show anymore. But I always wanted to like see, and like, I love if they, in this most recent season, like Santiago runs by on the football field and goes, hey, remember when we used to live together, buddy? Like, I know, that was fucking weird. Like, you never hear like, fucking, what's his name, Landry ever say, yeah, oh shit, we killed him, dude.
That is particularly like,
that's a big standout moment. Yeah. That's pure insanity.
There are things where like, the mom, what's her name? Connie Britton's character.
Oh, Tammy Taylor.
Tammy is she's going to work for the mayor, and then they just never mention that again. Wait, what noise did you make when we said Tammy?
I said, yeah. She's my favorite. Everyone's like, oh, are you a Lila or a Tara girl? And I was like, no, I am a fucking Tammy girl. I love Tammy, dude. I'm a Tammy guy, not Tammy girl. Whoops. So many Freudian slips in that sentence.
There's like four levels of it.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah, I'm in so deep. It's like the inception of Freudian slips.
Game of Thrones kind of managed to save that, though, because there were these cliffhangers that weren't like someone's jumping over the cliff and will they make a cliffhanger. Yeah. It was like there'd be a game changer and you were like, where are they just going next?
Exactly. And that was the thing. It's rather than being like, wait till you see what happens next, it'll be like, look what just happened. Wait till you see what that caused.
Yes.
Which was kind of cool. Like, rather than be like, something awesome is about to happen, Game of Thrones ended with something awesome happening and then saying, wait till you see how this changes everything. Rather than the classic cliffhanger of like, will Littlefinger pull his... Oh, I am... we'll pull out... Never mind. Spoiler alert. Save that. We're saving
it. We'll save that for the second half of the show.
Yeah.
But...
where I just rattle off everything that happens in all the books.
It seems like for HBO, Boardwalk Empire was going to be their prestige project for the year. It had Martin Scorsese. It had Steve Buscemi.
Yeah.
But I don't think people were talking about it nearly as much as they're talking about Game of Thrones.
Oh, gosh.
And I liked Boardwalk Empire an awful lot.
I liked Boardwalk Empire, too. And Boardwalk Empire was trashy, too, for a prestigious show. It was like, there was still a lot of trashiness to it. But there was just something about Game of Thrones where it's like, swords, magic, titties. Like, that's all you need to make a good show.
Someone said to me that they heard Game of Thrones was porny. And I disagreed with that because there's certainly a lot of nudity in it. But I wouldn't say it was obscene for obscenity's sake.
No, definitely not. It was no pornier than any other HBO show or any other action movie. It was like, you were watching, if you want to look at it like that, you're watching 10 58-minute action movies, you know what I mean? Or action-adventure movies that always have at least one sex scene, you know what I mean? All those movies do.
I feel like the best HBO shows, and this is true of other shows too, though, particularly true of HBO shows, the best HBO shows feel like a movie every week. Like, you watch A Wire, and you're like, I cannot believe that was only an hour.
And it's like, beats the hell out of you, you know? You're up and down, you're like, oh! Watching it on pay cable is especially interesting because then they do, you watch an episode of Treme and it's 59 minutes. You know what I mean? If you watch Mad Men, it's 40, 44, 30 or whatever Matt Wiener argues for.
I almost pulled back when I was saying HBO shows because I was thinking of Mad Men. Mad Men, every time you watch it, I feel like it's like going to the theater. You got to like
Yeah. Really pay attention to characters and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, but even when it's done, you're still only invested for... And it's like that extra 13 solid minutes, I think, that comes with an HBO show.
And Game of Thrones, or The Wire, is so dense. So much can happen in 13 minutes.
Oh my, yeah, I know. Exactly. And like, it's like, remember when you like watch a TV show and you're like, oh shit, it's 57. The show's almost over. Damn. Like a good show. I remember watching The Simpsons as a kid. And if I looked at the clock and it said like 56, 57 or 26, 27, I was like, damn it, the show's almost over.
Yeah.
When you're like watching The Wire or something like that, you're like, and you look at your DVD player or even if you watch on DVR or whatever, you're like, holy shit, there's still 12 minutes left. Everything's going on. There's still 12 minutes.
Yeah.
God knows what's going to happen.
The Wire and Game of Thrones, they have a lot in common besides
they do.
Besides Adrian, what's his name? The guy who plays...
Carcetti.
Carcetti.
Yeah, I don't know his real
it's
name.
It's Adrian something.
Yeah.
Gillian. Aiden Gillian.
Because he's an Irish dude.
And right? He's, you know what? He's great on both those shows.
He plays a very similar character.
But you know what? He's terrible in 12 Rounds with John Cena. He is the...
he's the worst bad guy. And of course, Rubin knows it's safe to bring up 12 Rounds with me.
You've seen 12 Rounds?
Of course.
This is amazing. I want to turn this into a 12 Rounds episode. That movie is terrible.
Oh, my God.
Pat and I watched it.
It's so bad. I watched it with Ben Rogers.
We're like two competing teams.
Yeah.
So you can watch the shittier movies. It's so bad. It's just like... Even the... Carcetti was a large reason I watched it, because I thought, like, he could be, like, you know, even in the worst action movie, like, the villain has a little room to be fun and, like, be,
yeah,
like...
Or, like, even just a good actor in a bad action movie sort of just stands out, where you're like...
Especially as the villain.
Yeah, he's like, oh, he's just doing something awesome. Wait, I'm trying to think of an example on the fly, but I...
Oh, I have a great one. Michael C. Hall in Gamer.
Oh, right, yes. Of course, I've seen Gamer. Yes, Michael C. Hall is awesome in Gamer. Yeah.
Which is a terrible, terrible movie.
Oh, man, that movie doesn't even make sense. I don't even understand the logic.
Wait, I want to get back to 12. I don't want to let 12 Rounds off the hook that easy.
Yeah, fair enough.
12 Rounds is a movie that stars pro wrestler John Cena, and the 12 Rounds refer to the 12 deadly rounds that Carcetti is going to put him through. But they're not really rounds, like... But he just, like, before the game even starts, like, his house blows up, and Carcetti calls him up, and he's like, I just won round one. And yeah. Like, well, that was one of the rounds?
Yeah. That movie should have just been called, like, I don't even, like, 12 is such an arbitrary number. I wonder how many times the name of the screenplay changed as they did rewrites. It's like, well, 25 rounds. Let's get it down to 10, at least, you know. Oh, how about we throw this round back in? Can we count the house blown up as first round? Yeah, let's just make that the first round.
You know what else he's the bad guy in, and I haven't seen in a while, so I can't comment on his performance, is... He's the bad guy in Shanghai Knights.
Oh, man. The Jackie Chan, Owen Wilson movie?
The Jackie Chan, Owen Wilson sequel.
Oh,
the
right.
First one, Shanghai Noon, where the pun kind of... Well, no, the pun makes sense in both of them. But, yeah, he's the bad guy in that, too.
Oh, wow. I will rewatch that tonight, if possible.
I have one last general Game of Thrones thing I want to talk about that anyone can listen to before we, like, start getting into the show itself. So when I get into something, like, I don't just start watching the TV show. I gotta be researching it. I gotta be reading Wikipedias about everyone involved in the show. So I read the George R. R. Martin Wikipedia, and the thing that really jumped out at me was that he had written a letter to Fantastic Four when he was 15 years old, and they ran it in the letters page. Because, you know, comic books, even to this day, they have... I wish you could see the grin on John's face right now.
This is so exciting to me.
He's so excited.
This is like a collision of two worlds. If you told me Katy Perry's tits were anywhere near there, I would just ejaculate.
He looks like a puppy, and there's like... someone just took out ice cream.
Yeah.
So, when he was 15 years old, he wrote a letter to Fantastic Four, issue 20. So this is like less than 2 years after Stan Lee and Jack Kirby are like starting to fuck shit up in the world of comic books. And I thought maybe I'd read the letter, because I think in some small way it maybe foreshadows what he gets into.
Yeah, maybe. Is it okay if I close my eyes?
Dear Stan and Jack, FF number 17 was greater than great. Even now I sit in awe of it, trying to do the impossible. That is, describe it. It was absolutely stupendous. The ultimate. Utmost. I cannot fathom how you would fit so much action into so few pages. It will live forever as one of the greatest FF comics ever printed, ergo as one of the greatest of all comics. Which is, you know, he's using hyperbole there, but he turned out to be correct. Like,
yeah.
People look back at that original run of Fantastic Four.
And being one of the best.
That's
yeah.
like the goal. That's where modern comics really
How
started.
Old was George R. R. Martin when he wrote that?
15.
15.
And isn't it interesting?
He's talking like Stan Lee.
Isn't it interesting that he talks about fitting so much action into so few pages?
Dude, he's mastered that. He's mastered that.
Like, there's times where I'm reading it and I'm like, oh my God, I think this guy just died. I gotta like go back up 2 paragraphs, you know?
Yeah,
like,
exactly. You're like, wait, what? Whose blood is on the sword?
Yeah.
You're like, oh, crap.
It really turns so quickly. I think you're a comic books guy too.
Yeah.
Hard, believe it or not.
Yeah. Weird overlap.
And you can kind of, Fantastic Four was like always about, tell me if I'm reaching here. Fantastic, and so I can edit it out later. Fantastic Four was always about, it wasn't, what elevated Fantastic Four was that it was not just a superhero comic. It was all about the family way that the family dynamics.
You were right, which is a lot of what Game of Thrones and so forth and so on. Like, because
I think what makes it special, and I fantasy has never been my favorite nerd subgenre. Yeah. I don't like fantasy very much. You have read a ton of fantasy books,
yes.
And it seems like what elevates Game of Thrones is that it's taken the usual fantasy trappings of lords and, you know, horses and treating people poorly,
yeah,
and put this layer of politics and family into it.
Yeah, I think politics is what really heightens it, because a lot of fantasy is not necessarily about family, but it's about tight-knit, close group of friends, so that the Dungeons & Dragons writer can insert 7 different characters. So there can be a halfling, a night elf, and a barbarian, and a dwarf. I'm specifically talking right now about the Drizzt Do'Urden series, if anyone can't
care. I know Drizzt. I never played Dungeons & Dragons, which is an action. This is not a sarcastic, believe it or not. I never played Dungeons & Dragons. But I can fake my way through Dungeons & Dragons conversation because I played Baldur's Gate 1 and 2.
Smart.
Which are fun. I didn't do it just for that.
I dedicated a year of my life to playing 2 different video games so I could cheat my way through the D&D convo. So I can get laid, more or less.
It was like a summer. I spent one summer and the only video games I played were Baldur's Gate 1, the expansion, Baldur's Gate 2, the expansion.
Yeah.
And they're an RPG from BioWare who's gone on to do Knights of the Old Republic and Mass Effect. And they, it was an RPG based in the Dungeons & Dragons world, and Drizzt Do'Urden makes a cameo.
Yeah, and it's like a huge deal. I played Baldur's Gate 1 and 2. Surprise, as well. Were they the same people that did Neverwinter Nights? Because I did that.
Is it? I think so.
Or not, that's on a D&D engine as well. So it's. Like,
I think Neverwinter Nights was, that's on the D20 engine?
Yeah.
Like Baldur's Gate is, what Baldur's Gate and what Neverwinter Nights does is it takes the Dungeons & Dragons rules and puts it into a video game.
Yeah.
So every time you hit someone, it's just like, there's an invisible hand rolling 10 dice.
And what it eliminates is, the most difficult part about Dungeons & Dragons is gathering 4 other people to play. You don't need anyone now. You're like, I can play D&D by myself. It's amazing.
And so Drizzt Do'Urden, I remember because he shows up and I'm like, who is this guy? And so, again, gotta know everything about it. I go to Wikipedia, learn, maybe Wikipedia wasn't around then, Google who he is, and he's like, he's kind of
Nexus.
He's kind of like the badass of the, who's I'm trying to think of who's a good example.
He's like the Boba Fett was perfect. A good guy.
Yeah.
Now literally we are, the Venn diagram of my life is overlapping to this conversation right here. I just referenced Drizzt Do'Urden and Boba Fett in the
Game of Thrones conversation.
In Game of Thrones conversations. While wearing, I thought I had a nerd shirt on. I have a old-timey barbell shirt on.
Perfect.
That's the only surprise about me, is that I enjoy lifting.
So Drizzt Do'Urden's like the total badass of the
Dungeons. Most badass motherfucker in all of Forgotten Realms.
And if you are playing Baldur's Gate, there is a really hacky, cheaty thing you can do, which it's not quite cheating, but like you gotta like pause it and unpause it real quick so he like can't hit you, and you can like steal his sword, which has a name.
Icing Death.
Oh my god, I'm so glad you knew the name. I was going to be like, I can't remember the name. Sure.
Oh wait, no, it's Frostbane. He steals it from the Frost Dragon Icing Death.
I was afraid I was going to have to be like, I can't remember the name. I'm sure someone will explain it and we'll put it in later.
But to be fair though, and this is the ultimate nerd caveat, is that Drizzt had 2 swords. He's a dual scimitar wielder. The other one is Twinkle, which lit up when evil characters were around.
Oh, but didn't they take that from Lord of the Rings?
That's, yeah.
If he didn't take it from somewhere else.
Yeah. His lights up when Sauron's, or
I think when orcs are near.
Yeah, when orcs are near. Right, Sting. That sword's name is Sting. But Twinkle, either that or it glows to light the path or something like that. I haven't read a Drizzt book in a while.
Why did we bring up Drizzt Do'Urden? What did it have to do with Game of Thrones?
I said fantasy books outside of Game of Thrones
right. Have
a family element.
They're written by
really
Dungeon
cares,
Masters.
Yeah, yeah. Drizzt really cares about Regis, the halfling, who cares about Wolfgar. You know, so there is a family element to it, and there's a lot of stuff like that. But it's a non-traditional family, if you will. But the politics of Game of Thrones is what jams it up to the next level.
And that's like, that's very wiry, I feel
like. Yeah, and that's what made The Wire good, was because, yeah, cop shows are cool as shit, you know, and, like, gangsters are cool as shit, but when it's, like, all the nightmare red tape and, you know, like, the shit that fucking Wait, what? What's the character's name? The main McManus? No.
Yeah, no, McNulty.
McNulty.
McManus is the bar.
Oh, right. McNulty is like the shit he gets into is very the politics is intriguing, and if you can make politics intriguing, one way to do that is to make it getting fucking people getting beheaded and shit like that.
And throw in as much nudity as possible.
Yeah.
So back to George R. R. Martin's letter. In what other comic mag would you see things like a hero falling down a manhole, a heroine mistaking a toy inventor for a criminal, and the president of the USA leaving a conference that may determine the fate of the world to put his daughter to bed? The epic story, spectacular and exciting as it is not all that made this mag so great. The letter column was top-notch, too. I nearly died when I saw Paul Gambaccini's letter. You've really made him change his tune. That letter was a far cry from the one printed in FF number 9. Then there's your cover boast. The world's greatest comic magazine. Brilliant. You were just about the world's worst mag when you started, but you set yourself an ideal and, by gumbo, you achieved it. More than achieved it, in fact. Why, if you were only half as good as you are now, you would still be the world's best mag.
Wow.
Very good.
Suck dick much, George Orwell? Chill out, you 15-year-old fucking brown noser.
I mean, I always wondered about the people who write letters to comics, to be honest.
To be honest with you, I've read comics my whole life. I never read the letters page. I can't believe he's referencing the letters page of a previous comic. Like, good work in the letters page, guys. Some intern at Marvel's like, thank God someone recognized my work.
I read the letters page because you get a comic book, you want to, like, you know, they're not cheap. You want to drink as much of it in, and you're like, I'm done. But there's still like some more, just even the slightest bit more entertainment to squeeze out of this.
Yeah, or you like go back and you look at your stat, your like pull from the week, and you're like, all right, let me just get, I'll read all the letters pages. All
yeah, you're like,
it's crazy though. The three things he describes is like, what other comic would have these three boring ass things in them?
You got to remember when Fantastic Four started, like what other comics had going on.
Yeah,
like it was like the first of like I think it's almost like a Citizen Kane where like when you look at things before it, it doesn't look like the what we think of as comic books now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
and it's cool that he was into that scene so young, like getting in on Fantastic Four within the first 2 years.
That's pretty awesome. Gives him a little street cred.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. It's crazy though that like, of course the guy who ends up writing fantasy for an entire life is really, and I'm sure he was also really into food and pornography when he was young too, because so much of Game of Thrones describes food and so much of it describes sex. It's insane.
With that, I think let's turn the corner here and get into the spoilerier end of the conversation.
Yeah.
So if you haven't watched Game of Thrones yet, you should stop listening to this because you should. This is my last opportunity. I want to. I give it my strongest recommendation.
Yes, I'd say go ahead and watch it, and watch past like the second episode because the first two episodes are good, but they're a little confusing. And then the third episode, I think it picks up. And
that's almost true of any good TV show. You need a little bit of time to get running.
Yeah, because it's just good storytelling. It's like exposition and like not. Shit can't happen in the first two episodes that would justify why it would be, you know, that's how it does. That's just not how good storytelling works. You never open up a book and you finish the first chapter and you're like, holy shit, this is going to be the best book I've ever read.
Yeah, it'd be like judging a movie on the first 10 minutes and being like, I don't like this.
I almost guarantee if you watch Game of Thrones for the whole season, you're going to love it and you're going to read all the books before the second season even comes out.
Let's start talking about the show specifically, best sex scene of the season.
The best sex scene of the season. All right, that's a good question because there's some awesome
there's
ones.
Some options.
I think my favorite one is when Carchetti, when Littlefinger's given his exposition explaining his character, there's just two girls practicing fingering each other.
Yeah.
That's fucking awesome, dude.
Was that in the book?
I don't remember specifically. There are a lot of fingers and cunts in books. There's a lot of that. It's like just a thing.
Which is so much grosser than fucking. Like,
yeah,
or
dude.
Not. I shouldn't say grosser. It's more. It's much
it's
more
vulgar.
Vulgar.
Yeah. It's graphic. It's like dirty knight's hands just like, jamming into women's pussies. Like the most intimate area, and the guy's just like workman. It's like, oh yeah, fuck me with a hammer. You know what I mean? It's like it's not sexual a hand. It's like especially a knight's hand, like just taking off like a metal gauntlet and immediately going into a woman's pussy.
Into a woman's pussy.
I was like so nervous to say it. I don't know why. I was like, are we allowed to talk about pussy?
Yeah.
Because we've been screaming about it until we turned the podcast recorder on. We're just like, yeah, me and Jeff, we love pussy.
The only way you can get me to say pussy is if we're talking about Game of Thrones
at
the time.
Yeah, to be fair. Same here.
What was great about that sex scene, and they use this trick a lot, is that while the sex scene is going on, Littlefinger is explaining his background and where the nickname Littlefinger comes from.
So much of the movie it just covers like exposition with sex.
It's funny you call it a movie because like that's just kind
of I didn't even mean to do that. So much of the show is like when there's another time too where like there's a weird scene that I don't remember from the book either where the old maester is pretending to be
Pyrell or something.
Yeah, Pyrell is trying to Pyrell. Yeah, he's trying to he's like just got a blowjob or whatever, and he's like he's telling a little backstory and stuff like that. It's like, why not just have a girl like tittering about with her fucking boobies hanging out?
But the problem is, after that scene happens, they go to the next scene. I was like, wait, what was his backstory?
Yeah, exactly. The whole time, I'm really into it and trying not to let my fiance know how into it I am in that scene. I'm just like, okay, yeah. Oh, interesting. I'm like, titties. This is also the most amount of times I've said titties into a microphone in my entire life.
Not me. The sex kind of dovetails with the plot, though. Like Daenerys, there's a lot of sex scene and a lot of nudity with Daenerys. But you it's a
reverse cowgirl is a plot point. I think you and I talked about it earlier. We've
gone over it, so I don't want. But yeah, like the sex is somehow related. Is related to her relationship with her the man who she is sold to, Khal Drogo.
Khal Drogo, the king of all the Dothraki. Yeah, it's really important to her becoming who she becomes. Spoiler alert: she becomes a fucking badass. Yeah. Dude. Yeah. She gets even more fucking awesome.
That last shot of the season was,
let's jump right to the ultimate spoiler. Yeah. The last frame of the last episode is Daenerys sitting there with three fucking dragons crawling around her nude body after she survived a night in a fire.
And I don't know how they're going to keep those dragons. Like, they kind of minimize the presence of the direwolves. Like, they're hard to depict. I don't know how they're going to have the dragons, and I don't know what the role of the dragons is in the upcoming books, but, like, it's difficult to imagine, like, a full-scale Helm's Deep dragon battle.
Yeah, I'm wondering how they're going to do that, too, and I'm sure it's going to be through, like, stupid shit, like, charging into battle, and then fucking the dwarf gets knocked unconscious, and then they wake up and the battle's over. Like, weird jumps to stuff like that.
You were telling me that the last scene was different. Is that the last chapter in the book? Like the last page?
I don't
page?
Remember what it is, but she's breastfeeds the dragons.
Which HBO very tastefully decided to leave out.
Like, we'll just have them crawling around her bare breasts. And clearly,
she'll still be naked.
Yes. And then someone else said this. I'm sorry if I'm quoting whoever, but I've been talking about Game of Thrones to everyone. Clearly in her contract was, I don't show bush, because then there's just a dragon sitting right in front of her bush.
I was watching the show with my girlfriend, and surprise.
Yeah, that's a genuine surprise on both of our parts.
Another one. I was watching the show with my girlfriend, and I commented on how much doggy-style sex there was in the first few episodes, and she was like, oh, that's because they worship horses, so they have sex like horses do, and I was like, that's the kind of flavor I'm missing out on by not reading the books.
Yeah, and also they fuck horses.
Oh, they fuck horses?
Or they reference the idea that they fuck. I think they even say it. I think Jorah says at one point, he's like, they lie with horses. You know what I mean? They eat, they ride, eat, and lie with horses or something like that. Yeah.
That's another way that it's like Deadwood.
They fuck horses in Deadwood?
Well, have you not watched Deadwood?
No, Deadwood's an HBO show that's next on my
phone. Oh, you gotta watch Deadwood.
Yeah.
Guy jerks off on a horse in Deadwood.
It's real weird.
You know what's weird is that actually happened when I was at college and I went to Penn State, which is in the middle of a lot of farmland. It's a rural school. And so there was a point where someone by one of the nearby farms masturbated on a horse. And I remember seeing it, I was just having a shitty day or something, and I saw in the paper there was a headline that was like, local man masturbates on horse. And I've heard...
And it wasn't The Onion. It was
No. And it made my day. I remember, like, it really, like, turned around my day, and I actually took the time to write the author and be like, I had a, you know, I was having a shitty day, I saw your story, it really cheered me up. And what's really embarrassing is my roommate would go on to write for the newspaper, and then, like, I met her a few years later, and I was like, oh, I wrote you that letter, and she was like, that was you.
Dude, I want to say right now, we were just talking about this a little bit earlier, and now as you told me that story, I think that's what makes someone a true nerd or geek. Someone like, and you're a good example of it, like you're not necessarily down any one path too deep, but a guy who watches a TV show and wikis every single character, every single person attached to it, a guy who reads an article in something and writes a letter, like George R. R. Martin writing to Stanley.
I didn't learn Pycelle's name just by watching the TV show.
Yeah, exactly. So that's like, there's something, like, I think that's a good example of a nerd, someone who goes above and beyond to get more information about something they enjoy.
I don't know why I started telling that story about the guy Oh, because I've heard of a lot of people masturbating on
horses. Yeah, because it happens in Deadwood.
I think that's just a thing people do when they're at their rope's end is like, I guess I'll just jerk off on this horse. I don't know why. I just appeal. Like,
you see, I think it goes the other way. I think it's something you do when you're on top of the world. When you're like a rich fucking king, you're like, bring a horse in here. I'm going to jerk off onto it.
I guess like...
I've come into hotel towels so many times I want to come on a horse.
Like jerk... Like if you were fucking the horse, I don't want to say I could understand that, but it makes a little more sense to me.
Yeah, I think jerking off on a horse is even more specific like, why not, of a fetish than fucking a horse.
Like, why not just think about the horse while you're jerking off?
Yeah, if you're gonna jerk off, do you need the smell of the horse? He has, like, a bag of horse hair that he sniffs while he's at home. Yeah, let's change the subject. Let's somehow transition back to Game of Thrones.
My girlfriend, she likes fantasy books. Again, surprise. Yeah. And
that's a surprise. That's like a double. That's an Inception surprise again. There, like,
it's a surprise and a surprise.
Yeah, like I have a girlfriend, and also it's a girl that likes fantasy. But then that retroactively makes that I have a girlfriend surprise less surprising.
See,
we're on the way back up through the Inception levels. We're hearing the music and we're shooting back up to reality. Kick. Yeah, kick me. For those of you, you know, you can't see, Jeff is floating around the room like Joseph Gordon-Levitt, putting his Settlers of Catan boxes back on shelves.
She likes the books that have fake maps in the first few pages.
It is very helpful. Almost every Forgotten Realms book has a map in the front of it, which is awesome.
And Lord of the Rings does it too.
Lord of the Rings does it too, but, yeah. But good they did that with the credits, right? The credits
and what's are now cool about that is they did... and people don't even notice this, but the credits change week to week depending on where they go that week.
Do they? Do
yeah,
because I
do.
Said they did that, and someone said no.
I have this exact same experience. I said they did that, and someone was like, they can't be doing that. And I was like, yeah, you're right. And then I looked it up. I was like, no, they are doing that.
Oh, shit. I don't know who I argued with this, but fuck you. I was right.
I don't think it changes dramatically. I think there's like 5 or 6 different blocks, and you get like 4 of them depending on where they are that week. Yeah. Like if they just don't go to the east, you just don't see that.
Yeah.
But you maybe see where was the place with the sky dungeons, which were awesome, by the way.
Oh, the spire? No, something like the Eyrie. Yeah,
and that was like there was like the hole. You know, they were in the map. There was like the hole too.
Yeah.
With the big drop in it.
Oh, that was awesome. That was a great scene. That character Bronn, Tyrion's like dude. He's awesome in the books, but he's the actor that's playing him is making it so fucking cool.
He stood out. That was a thing where I was like, who was that guy? Like, why did they do that? And then they didn't explain it until I think actually the episode after that was maybe the one episode of the season that Tyrion wasn't in, and then they explained it like 2 weeks later.
Oh yeah, we mean where they won, where he's like having. He's with the prostitute and Bronn, and they have like that game of truth or dare.
Yeah.
Another good example of how to get exposition out. It's like, how do we explain these three characters' backgrounds? It's like, well, let's have them just ramble on during a game of sexy truth or dare.
Yeah, I'm surprised more shows don't use truth or dare just for...
Yeah, it's like truth. Okay, here's my character's reason for doing everything.
What is your motivation?
Yeah, yeah.
Dare.
I choose dare. Take your top off. I don't know. I love... I love all fantasy. I played D&D growing up again. Surprise. But there's something about Game of Thrones. And this is sort of why I like Game of Thrones. And it's not my favorite. Like, the Drizzt Do'Urden books are my favorite. But I think Game of Thrones is good gateway fantasy.
You said that to me last time we spoke about this. And you said that because there wasn't much magic or anything.
There's not a huge buy-in up top where you have to believe in a lot. Like, with D&D-based fantasy, it's like... Most of the people who read that have played D&D, so like a halfling, an orc, and all this shit, you sort of have a picture in your head from the Monstrous Manual, or also you already buy in that all these different crazy things exist. And I feel like what's cool about Game of Thrones is like dragons are unrealistic to everyone. You know what I mean? So it's sort of like you can play along with other people like magic, no way. Ghosts, no fucking way. Yes, they exist, but most
zombies?
Characters... Yeah, exactly. Ice zombies or whatever you want to call them.
Yeah.
And like, they... like, so it's gateway in that way where you don't have to buy in right away up top. And then it's also like gateway in that it's the characters' names, as crazy as they are, they don't have like 4 apostrophes in each name.
Most
like,
of them, though.
Yeah.
Daenerys, once you start reading it, is a little iffy.
Oh, yeah. A lot of those names are crazy. And like, and thank God there's a TV show to tell you how to say everything.
Yeah.
That was like when I first saw the Harry Potter. I think we talked about this.
We
I
did.
Saw Harry Potter. I was like, oh, that's how you say everything.
Yeah. Thank God they named the main character Ned.
Yeah. They gave him like the fucking nerd. Ned the Head. Needle Nose Ned.
I can't believe that I had no idea. I was totally surprised when they killed him off. I feel like I'm Thank you, everyone that read the books, for not spoiling that for me. I can't believe
it was huge. It was awesome to know that that was going to happen to everyone. Like, literally so many people were like, oh, he's alive. Oh, by the way, here's the biggest spoiler if you're an idiot and are still listening to your podcast or you're on an elliptical or something like
yeah.
that. Yeah. If you're on an elliptical, you're not listening to the Jeff Rubin podcast. But if you are, for some reason, still listening to it, Ned Stark, the main character,
who's
dies.
Who's on the poster.
Doesn't even die in the final episode. He doesn't even make it to the final episode.
That's, again, very Wire-like. Every Wire season, the pacing is so that, like, the biggest thing of the season, like the climax of the story, isn't the last episode. It's always the second to last episode.
Yeah.
And then the last episode is kind of dealing with the fallout. Like,
yeah.
Whoa, hold on there, Jeff. This is future Jeff coming in, adding something to this recording, because past Jeff is about to drop some major spoilers for The Wire. So if you haven't watched The Wire yet, skip ahead about 20 seconds. And whether this warning was necessary is something John and I will discuss in about 20 seconds. Okay, so last chance, skip ahead about 20 seconds from now. Every Wire season, the pacing is so that, like, the biggest thing of the season, like the climax of the story, isn't the last episode. It's always the second to last episode.
Yeah.
And then the last episode is kind of dealing with the fallout. Like, yeah. That's where Frank Sabaka gets killed in the second to last episode. I believe Wallace gets killed in the second to last episode of the first season. Stringer dies in the second to last episode
of
the third season. Oh, my God. I should probably warn people. That's the thing about spoilers. Like, do I have to? The Wire's like 7 years old. Do I have to warn people that it's
being
spoiled?
Yeah, there's something weird about that. By the way, it's Brad Pitt's wife's head in the box. Like, at the end of seven. Like, what am I supposed to tell you?
People are still discovering The Wire, and I don't know if I should ruin. Those are three major plot points I just ruined for everybody.
Yeah, I guess. Whoops. Sorry about that.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe do I have
Can
to
you
warn
do a break
people?
In? Can you do a quick break in there?
I guess so. Do I have to warn people about that?
That's not on you anymore. That's not on you. We are talking. We were talking a lot about The Wire up top. If that came out of nowhere, Bruce Willis is dead the whole time, then, like, we don't want to spoil something necessarily.
What's, like, the statute of limitations of spoilers for TV shows? Because I feel like for movies, it's a little different because everyone's getting to it at the same time. But with DVR and DVD, like, some people just don't get HBO. And this is unbelievable to me. They're going to have to wait till it comes out on DVD to watch it.
I know. That's crazy because there is no HBO on iTunes, right? Now they have HBO Go, but it's not supported by so many
people. You have to subscribe to HBO to get HBO Go. You can't just, like, pay $10 a month for it.
Yeah, exactly. And you can't also get it if you have Time Warner anyway.
Which makes total sense. Is the
Time Warner effortlessly fucking every step of the way. Yeah, and I don't know what the statute. That's a good question. With TV, it's difficult because people are catching. But also with movies, it's like, fuck, I didn't get to see it in the theaters. No spoil. You know what I mean? And you could avoid articles about it, but when someone comes up casually in conversation.
I feel like with movies, it's a little clear. There's, like, a time where everyone either saw the movie.
If it's out of the theaters, I feel like you're allowed to start
talking about it. Yeah, and then, like, after it's out on DVD for a week or two, like, if you haven't seen it, you're probably not going until it's on TBS. And then, like,
and
fuck
that annoys me when people are like, oh, dude, what? Come on, man. It's like, chill the fuck. You haven't seen it yet. You clearly don't have a desire to see it. Unless you're like, sorry, I've been dealing with the death of my parents for the last 2 years. And you're like, okay, sorry. Now I feel really bad.
But I had a friend who was into, I have a friend that didn't watch Lost. And whenever we talked about Lost, he'd be like, oh, no, don't spoil it for me. I'm going to watch it eventually. So for, like, 3 years, he was like, just planning on getting
it. I'll tell you
to.
What, in 2014, that guy's going to be the worst guy to hang out with. He's going to be like, wasn't that crazy with Mr. Echo? And you're going to be like, I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. And that's another thing, though, dude, when you watch a series, like, way after everyone else, and you're like, does anyone here want to talk about The Wire? And they're like, no, I have watched it 5 years ago. And you're like, oh, man.
I think that's why people are like, dude, you got to watch The Wire.
Because I
need
talk
someone
to, you.
To talk
yeah,
to
exactly.
about it.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that.
Let's get back to Game of Thrones. I was very surprised, as I already said, when they killed off Ned, which made me even more surprised when they killed off Khal Drogo, because I just assumed we had already gotten our death for the year.
Yeah.
And he was such a good character, and that was a tough role to play, you know?
To be, like, an absolute badass and, like, have to give a crazy monologue in a fucking made-up language. That scene was insane. Like, I'm like, why am I so into this? The dude is literally speaking gibberish. It's not even gibberish to me. It's gibberish to the entire world. And he's just like,
but with such conviction, he totally owned it.
That was awesome. That was like a 8th grade acting exercise. It's like that's a short form improv game.
Yeah.
Like, pretend you're saying something important in gibberish.
I looked up. I was like, "Who is this dude?"
He's the new Conan.
Oh yeah, and which looks terrible. That new Conan movie.
I will see it opening night.
which is why they're making it. But what's her name? That she's in that movie Jawbreaker. I didn't want to. The first thing I think of
Rose
is
Rose McGowan.
Yeah, the first thing I think of is she used to date Marilyn Manson, but I didn't want to define her that way. I didn't want to, like, get into the celebrity gossip shit.
Yeah.
She has looks fucking. Did you see what she looks like in that movie?
No, she's in Conan.
She's like this crazy witch lady, and they did some like weird thing to her that makes her unrecognizable. It looks kind of like Dune. It looks like it's from that David Lynch Dune.
Yeah,
but it's like. I know the point is that it looks weird, but I think it's like a little too weird past that where it's like actually creeping me out.
Yeah, yeah, it's uncomfortable. Like Khal Drogo looked a little weird.
Yeah,
because he had those giant B cups or whatever, but he still looked like enough like a human that you were like into, you know, you were like could watch into him. You were really into him. I know you were, Jeff. He rips a fucking dude's throat out with a tongue attached to it.
That scene
was awesome when he drops the knives.
Yeah.
And he's
like,
let's do this dirty. And the other guy he just lets himself get cut and then he pulls his fucking throat out. That's the second throat rip out, right? Because the wolf does it to the guy who attacks Bran while he's sleeping.
Maybe. I remember that scene, which was also. I think that scene maybe where I was like, because that's in the second or third episode.
Yeah, that was the first major crazy action.
That might be the scene where I was like, I'm in.
It's because it stayed on the throat, it stayed on a center frame, the throat. After the direwolf ripped out a big chunk, stayed on it, beat, blood gurgle. I was like, that's crazy.
And then there's the also great where like the guy has his knife around Caitlyn's throat, and she grips it as hard as she can. Yeah, and, like I don't
to that, save herself, and like you see it on her. Like,
and yeah. I was like, you know, that I think that was the moment where I was like, I'm into this show.
That's
grabbing
Valyrian steel like that. They can really fuck your hands up.
I'm impressed. It was like a dragon bone hilt or something.
Yeah,
that's a plot point.
That's a major plot point. Yeah, the Valyrian steel. It's like who would send? It's so much shit. I don't even want to get into it because it's so many good specifics.
It's just so much. And this was, if I was to criticize the show. I like it, and I'm curious to see where it goes. It feels a little bit like it wasn't a story, and it was just a bunch of stuff that happened. Do you think that's fair?
I could see that. It's hard for me, though, because I'm retroactively putting a story I know on top
right.
of it. But I think if I had to criticize the show, I think it should have slowed down a little bit. Not in like, but like, I found myself like watching it with like friends that I've never seen it before and sort of being a guide of some sort. You know what I mean? I'm like, oh, I feel bad. But like, there's a lot of fucking characters and a lot of plot lines.
Yeah, I felt like I didn't have trouble following it. But there was one point where there was
But I feel like, oh, I'm sorry. He's the cousin that they reference in the
yeah.
preview? Oh, okay, I see. That's the son. That's the brother. You know, like, I constantly have to be like, yes, he's married to her. They're twins. They're fucking this, that, the other thing, yeah.
There was one point where I was like, so he's him and she's him? And my girlfriend who was watching was like, yeah. And I was like, all right, you know what? I think I got this. And that very episode, some kid walks out and I'm like, who is this dude? And she's like, he's the fifth Stark kid. And I was like, there's a fucking another one
yeah,
of them?
Yeah, the baby. Rincon, yeah.
Like, I really, like, finally declared myself, like, I finally thought I had a handle on the show. And it was like, and it was
oh,
like.
Oh, yeah, there's this kid. They don't mention Rincon for like six episodes, yeah.
I think they mention that there's five Stark kids, but at that point, like, the one who Greyjoy is kind of like you're not totally who's
yeah.
not a Stark kid. It's not
yeah.
You don't totally understand that relationship. Yeah. There's a lot to get. But like The Wire, you can't do the crossword puzzle while you watch it or anything. But but if you pay attention, it is there, and you can certainly get the broad strokes.
Yeah, exactly. And then like it's a good show to rewatch. I bet, especially now once you know everyone. And
you said when we talked about it before, I was really into it at the start of the season. That you could see, if you knew it was coming, there were things they were doing that were like foreshadowing. And
yeah.
Like little jokes. Are there any of those that you can explain having just seen the first season of the show?
Yeah, well, like there's that really awesome scene, and it's like even within the season, it starts to justify itself. But like when she gets in the really hot bath,
yeah,
Garrus, and they're like, "That's too hot, Mrs." And she just gets in and she's fine, and she's like, "Oh, weird," you know what I mean? And then later on, they hit it again when she like picks up something that's supposed to be hot.
That's in the very yeah. I didn't even notice the bath thing. I guess that's
yeah.
what makes it foreshadowing. Is that
yeah.
like it was a little subtle? But that's in the very first episode where I'm still like, "Who are these people?" Well, now we're somewhere else. Who are
yeah,
these people?
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
So, like, the temperature of her bath was not totally
yeah,
registering with me
yeah,
at that
but
point.
But then when you know that the dragon's blood is coursing through her veins,
right.
it all makes sense. And then you know she's going to be... If I can think of stuff that comes up later in the season... Oh, there's, like... Daenerys talk about mercenaries? I feel like she talks about raising an army and stuff like
uh-huh.
that, which is a great... Because, like, she ends up... Super spoiler alert, fuck it. She ends up mounting like an insane army and just fucking...
Wait, I don't know about the rest of the show, the rest of the books.
Oh, you don't want to get spoiled?
No.
We said spoiler alert.
No, just the TV show, none of the books.
All right, fair enough.
I don't want to talk about it.
I'm sorry, I ruined you. Jeff is his mascara is running down his face as he cries. There was I'm trying to think of other things that happened in the book that are in the show that you could see and like, oh shit, that's gonna mean something.
Yeah,
like, but I'm failing.
Tough right ones now. That it's tough to think. Probably think of one. I imagine that is contained all within this first season.
You know what wasn't in the book? At least I don't remember it was in the book, and maybe it says more about me than anything else. It's like I don't remember a graphic or like listening to a graphic blowjob between the King's brother and the Knight of Flowers.
Yeah.
I don't even think the Knight of Flowers is ever outright gay in the books. I think everyone assumes he is because every girl pines after him, and he's very beautiful, and he's the Knight of Flowers. But I don't remember him getting his dick sucked
by Renly.
By Renly Baratheon.
Right. You know, HBO, it's got a little something for everyone.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like that would be the thing where if, like, that would be the thing that, like, no other network exec would push except for HBO. They're like, well, if this character might be gay, why don't we get him, have him get his dick sucked and shaving nipples in this scene when they're both just going over plot line. Like, when they're just both hammering out storylines. But that, like, I'm pretty comfortable with
that's gays. Very Deadwood, by the way. Deadwood has long monologue. Like, it's a recurring theme almost. It happens, at like, 3 or 4 times over 30 episodes. Where Al Swearengen, who you're gonna love, he's the Tyrion of this show.
Yeah,
it's the Ian McShane character, and he has a lot of blowjob monologues where he's getting a blowjob, and he's like, and the show's very Shakespearean too. There's monologues, but no one ever just turns to the camera, and they're always talking to an animal.
Yeah,
and for him, it's like while he's getting a blowjob, he'll pontificate about where he came from.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, I'm excited for it. I've already been pumped for Deadwood for a while.
You're going to love the show.
But I'm also not the guy that people are talking about Deadwood. I don't turn and sprint away. You know what I mean? It's my fault. I haven't seen it yet.
Deadwood's a little harder to spoil than, say, The Wire or Game of Thrones or Lost, where like it's so character-based that, like, I don't know. Things happen throughout the season, but like if you know someone's dying or you know what's going to happen,
it's not
more about the journey than the destination.
Oh, cool.
More than the loss.
We just got really fucking philosophical and stoned out of nowhere.
I was just quoting Aerosmith.
You're always quoting Aerosmith. The rich, man. It's the only one thing they're really that good for.
If people listen to the spoiler half of this without watching the show, I bet it really makes them want to watch the show because all we talked about was like blowjobs, lesbians, and like horses getting decapitated.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Great ad for the show.
And I almost guarantee that you can't remember the names that when you watch if you only listen to this podcast once, you can watch the season and still be surprised because you can't remember who the fuck is who.
John, I want to talk about what you're doing right now, what you came from shooting.
Oh, yeah. I'm shooting an MTV series, a game show called The Substitute. It's sort of like, this is probably the least newsy, like, press releasey way to explain it, but it's like...
This is it. Are we breaking this news right now?
Yeah, I guess I've never officially told anyone in any... I think it was referenced in an Entertainment Weekly.
Jeff Rubin show exclusive, assuming you don't read Entertainment Weekly.
I'm hosting a show for MTV called The Substitute, which is like an ambush game show in a high school classroom. So sort of like Cash Cab, but in a high school classroom. I come in under the auspices that I'm a substitute teacher and then spring on the kids that they're going to be competing for $5,000.
I love when... it sounds awesome, and I think you're going to be a great host for it. I'm going to watch it. And I love that. I love when you hear an idea for a TV show and you're like, yep, that's a TV show.
Yeah, that's what when they said to me, I was like, oh, I don't know if I necessarily want to be a game show host, but that show idea, I can't believe that show doesn't exist.
Exactly. Yeah. You can't believe it already doesn't exist. So, yeah. And you've shot, it's been going well.
We've shot 18 episodes. We're shooting 20. It's been going really well.
Isn't school, I don't want to blow your cover, isn't school kind of out right now?
Yeah, these last couple episodes we're shooting are very special college episodes, so we could do summer classes. Yeah.
I thought you were like going to summer school and like everyone's just getting...
We're just dumbing the questions down like insanely. Like, just point to America on a map, please.
Are there questions you like high schoolers should know, or are they just like general trivia? Are they like high school curriculum questions, or are they just general trivia?
It's like the first round is literally things you should know, a high school curriculum. Then the second round is pop culture. Then the third round is sort of like activity-based, like a physical challenge. And then the fourth round, the final round is like a Family Feud, like polling style question. It's really cool. And I don't know. It's probably not going to be for everyone because it's a lot of like high energy, because it's MTV. There's a lot of high energy screaming. But I get to make fun of the kids a lot. And Jeff knows I'm pretty decent at that.
Amazing at that.
Yeah. So we have a good time. And it's also just cool to give kids money, dude. Like, I don't know why. Like, I'd much rather take it myself. But there's something cool about giving away $5,000 to a classroom full of kids, and they go apeshit for it. You know what I mean?
I mean, it sounds great. It sounds perfect for you. Yeah. You're one of my favorite people to have on any of these shows. Thanks so much for doing this.
Anytime you want me to sweat my balls off on your couch and talk about some nerd topic, Let me know. If you ever fucking buck up and read the Drizzt books, we can have a whole nother
fucking... I can't believe I'm reading these fucking Game of Thrones books.
It's Gateway Fantasy, dude. Cannot... You're going to need the next fix. You're going to be like, this is good, but I need crazier fucking races.
I'm reading it and I'm enjoying it. I'm like, am I missing something by not reading more fantasy novels?
You know what's also... Fantasy is always usually very, not poorly written, but simply written.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like pure storytelling. It's not like... They're not in for the flowery language. The images or the content is flowery in and of itself. So they're not usually like... elaborate, you know, like interesting words, you know what I mean? It's just like simple. It's like slash him across his throat, cut his fucking head off, you know? So it's like,
you know, it's funny. I've been reading it on my iPad, and I feel like that's slightly less nerdy than walking around with a 1,000-page book on the subway.
Oh, no shit, dude. No,
like,
shit.
That's like, it's reading on an iPad, you look kind of weird on the subway, but you look less weird than you would with the 1,200-page.
Especially if the 1,200-page book is bright red with a griffin on it and it says a storm of swords. You know what I mean? Like, everyone's like, I know what that kid is reading. Dude, the Drizzt books have pictures on the cover of the paperback. It's a fucking nightmare to read on the subway. It's a picture of, like, a black dude with long white hair wielding two scimitars and, like, a astral plane panther following him alongside. You're like, fuck, dude. I can't read this on the subway and be looked at by anyone.
I think maybe what defines a true nerd is being willing to do that.
Yeah, I have to, dude. I'm not going to read at home. I'm going to play video games at home. If I'm out and about, I'll read.
When does the show start?
I think it airs September 12th, but don't quote me on that. I'm sure. I hope to be on another one of these episodes before the summer is out.
we'll talk about it between now and then, but we'll keep an eye out for it. Thanks again, John.
Hey, no, thank you, Jeff.
That just about does it for this week's show. Join us next week for a conversation about one of my other passions, pizza, with Scott of Scott's Pizza Tours. You can stay on top of new episodes of the show at my blog. That's Jeff Rubin, jeffrubin.com. On Twitter, that's @JeffRubinShow. And of course, there's a Facebook fan page. See you guys next week and come hungry.